Welcome to Shades of Us. I'm your host, Daryl Brown. The world of comic books has drawn in many fans with fantastic stories that take place in worlds very similar to our own.
Heroes often do battle with made-up menaces that are really a metaphor for real-world issues. The comic book industry has been dealing with its own adversaries lately. Chief among them is a call for more diversity in the sector. But how much representation from the real world is being illustrated? On this episode, we'll hear from some people in New York City's comic book community who discuss what they're seeing in the evolution of the industry. According to a 2017 study on gender representation of comic book characters, of the nearly 35,000 different characters examined, 30% of all superhero teams have no women. Only 12% have more female team members than male.
America Chavez from last year's Doctor Strange film, and Jaime Reyes, aka Blue Beetle, who will have a film of his own this summer, are just two of the Latino heroes gaining prominence in mainstream comics. However, before they drew top billing, there was another independent creator who sought to highlight his Hispanic heritage through a Latina hero.
I am here because of many artists in the comic book industry who paved the way and opened doors for Puerto Ricans like myself to be given these opportunities. My name is Edgardo Miranda-Rodriguez. I am a graphic novelist, creator of the superhero series La Borinquena, and I'm also a philanthropist. La Borinquena, otherwise known as Marisol Rios de la Luz, she's a superhero who is an Afro-Puerto Rican from New York City, an undergraduate student studying environmental sciences, but she moved to Puerto Rico to study abroad with her grandparents. When I created La Borinquena, I wanted to embrace nationalism. La Borinquena comes from the original name of Puerto Rico, Borinquen. So in creating this character, I've always identified my heritage, my island, my people, with this beauty of accepting the power of femininity, this beautiful power that comes from the women in our lives. It was around early 2016 when I was actually a published author for the first time. I had just written a story for Marvel Comics, an adventure with Groot and the Thing of the Fantastic Four. That story was co-written by Daryl McDaniels of Run-DMC, and the two of us put this story together. And in that story, I injected a narrative that Groot was actually connected to Puerto Rico's national tree, the ceiba. Everyone started talking about that book throughout the entire Puerto Rican diaspora. What introduced me to many institutions like the Center for Puerto Rican Studies, Loisaida Inc., an organization here in New York City, and the National Puerto Rican Day Parade, because they reached out to me to offer me an honor. So that was actually how La Borinquena came about in 2016. That platform allowed me the microphone, the cameras, the outlets to talk about Puerto Rico in a way that had not been talked about, particularly via popular culture. Stephanie Janes Martin, a Puerto Rican who had just graduated from law school, dressed as La Borinquena, and she showed the world this character for the first time at the National Puerto Rican Day Parade. That experience was incredibly magical for me because Stephanie literally starts telling the children, "Let me see your superpowers. Show me your superpowers." They were staring at a Puerto Rican superhero for the first time in their life. One of the things that was important to recognize in creating this comic book series is that it was going to be independently produced by our studio. Our studio is Somos Salte. I've been a creative director here in New York City for just over 20 years. My partner and I, Kyung, have been developing websites, providing brand identities. When we decided that this project was going to happen, La Borinquena, out of our own resources, we decided, let's self-produce this, let's self-publish this. And I think that coming from a perspective as two people of color running this business really does give us a sense of empowerment and ownership, because these books and this intellectual property are something that we developed. And it gives us the freedom to create collaborations with multiple brands. We have the right to produce action figures, create chocolate bars, design art shows for galleries and museums. Through the sales of our books, through collaborations that we've had, we've been able to dedicate a significant amount of time, energy, and money to our philanthropic work in Puerto Rico, awarding microgrants to nonprofits throughout the island. We believe in this model of giving back. We believe in this form of activism that is connected to actually making transformative work. And during the pandemic, we actually teamed up with a group of activists across the United States to start an organization called Masks for America. This illustration of La Borinquena literally wearing a mask became this icon that helped us raise millions of dollars to buy PPE to distribute across the United States. It was in 2021 that I decided that I was going to start producing our third graphic novel, La Borinquena number 3. And I realized that that ending was very dark, given how dark our reality was during the pandemic. I had a conversation with my two sons, and I told them, guys, I'm going to redo the ending of this book, and it's going to be uplifting, and I'm going to introduce a new team of superheroes, the Ni Taínos. Ni Taínos actually comes from the Taíno language and culture. These were the nobles that protected the caciques, the chieftains. My youngest son looked to a vejigante mask. Vejigantes are these masks that are made in Puerto Rico. There are two types of masks. One mask is actually made out of paper mache, but then the other one is actually made from the husk of a coconut shell. So my youngest son starts creating a character inspired by this mask, and some time later, he showed me this illustration. It came to me to create the superhero Oro, El Coqui Dorado, and they emphasized that La Borinquena's team, they should be all women. You know, so we decided to kind of like flip the archetype of superhero teams on its head. So it's actually all women except for one guy, and that's Oro, El Coqui Dorado. So all of these superheroes are now part of our series. And it's exciting because after 5 years, we decided to expand the universe by adding more characters. Educators see the value of our work, and they support us through their direct purchases of our publications, libraries. See the readable value of our work. And it's something incredibly like humbling when institutions that supported me growing up are now looking to bring my books into their collections so that they can also be shared with generations to come. Walking through the Comic-Con floor at Jacob Javits and seeing those hundreds, if not close to 1,000 people at that event, reminded me just 1 year into making La Borinquena how important this project was to other people. It wasn't just a project that was for me anymore. It was a project that was giving people affirmation, it was giving people hope, and it was giving people a character that celebrated them, that celebrated their identity. Young women as little as 8 to as old as probably like their 60s dressing up as La Borinquena. Celebrities like Rosario Dawson, who actually dressed up as La Borinquena 1 year herself. Celebrities who have actually approached me, like Anthony Ramos or Luna Velez, John Leguizamo, Ruben Blades, all of these celebrities that I admire for their collective work. There's this phrase that people always say, when one door closes, another one opens. In the case of La Borinquena, when doors closed in front of me, I chose to create my own door. And by creating my own door, I'm opening other doors for many others. And I hope that this art and this character inspires others. Just as a child, I was inspired by superheroes. I hope that this character inspires others to see the power and what makes them super within themselves.
Over 94 million copies of comic books and graphic novels were sold in 2021. Sales increased by nearly 50% compared to 2020, when stores were heavily affected by the pandemic.
Next up, a Brooklyn comic book store owner describes the changes he's seen in the comic world for many people in the community he serves.
I think the market is definitely much more diverse than when it started. It's by choice and demand. Customers demand it, the clients demand it.
My name is Hank Kwon. I'm the owner of a shop in Brooklyn called Bulletproof Comics. We sell comic books, cards, and skateboard. We've been here for 30 plus years. We're next to Brooklyn College and Midwood High School. We get a lot of students. My customer base are pretty diverse. We are predominantly in a Caribbean neighborhood. About 25% are from the Jewish background because I'm so close to Midwood. So we have to cater to both. It used to be pretty dangerous back in the day, in the 90s and early 2000s. So the store was always a safe haven for the kids to come. And a lot of them, they come from, you know, difficult backgrounds, or they're, because of the streets, they're very tough. And when they come into the store, it kind of ignites imagination and an alternative for them. And for a few hours, they could relax and be themselves and let them, you know, they could geek out. The comic book culture is mainly male-driven. So probably I have to say about 85, 90%. It used to be higher. It used to be like 99% all male-driven. Seeing a female reader was like finding a unicorn. But that has started to change about 20 years ago. There's definitely more diversity. There's more women characters, and there's more women writers. And they're writing more uplifting, non-sexualized characters about women. Prior to that, women were extremely sexualized. So we see women as not objects, but, you know, real people. And they also have superheroes, but a lot of memoirs and a lot of stories that need to be told. In 93, a brand new imprint called Vertigo started within DC. And within that imprint, a title called Sandman by Neil Gaiman started. Probably one of the most well-written comic series of all time. That brought in a lot of the women audience because it kind of transcended the medium. It just spoke to everyone. Saga is doing the same thing. So Saga and Brian K. Vaughan is bringing a lot of the women audience into comic shops. The premise is a couple, they have a baby, but they come from two different cultures. So it's a forbidden love, and everybody's trying to kill them because both sides don't want this marriage to happen. There's a lot of racism there, hidden racism, if you could look in there. We just did a show called Schomburg, and this convention is very unique because it's of creators of color under one roof. And it's held at the historical Schomburg Library in Harlem. And it's a two-day event, and it's there to really celebrate all the creators of color and how the creators of color are giving back to the community. When a fan has a interest in animation or comic books or coloring or anything of that media, when they see a person of color creating that content and it looks just like them, it creates a spark, creates a different interest. And it creates a new generation of people that's willing to go into the industry because they could see that it's possible. You know, there's other conventions or similar things like that. There's the LGBT events like that all over. I used to buy my comics through a local pharmacy. They had a spin rack. And I was more like a casual reader. I would just buy a comic and just read it. And it was nothing major until I picked up a book by a gentleman named Frank Miller. It was the Daredevil number 179. And the cover was stunning. It was a character called Elektra, and she was holding a Psy and a mask of Daredevil. When I seen the Psy on the Daredevil 179, because I had a martial arts background, I was just engrossed in the martial arts culture. That was the most important thing to me. You know, I was just couldn't get enough of it, just going practicing every day. And probably that Psy probably, and the martial arts aspect probably drew me to it. And when I read it, it was extremely authentic. The movements, the way the characters were, I guess, composed, it just struck me. It was the most awesome book that I read, and it was almost cinematic. And so I'm sure that my martial arts background drew me to it. I came to this country in 1975 and I didn't speak a lick of English. Yeah, we stayed in an area called Flushing, New York, and we were the second Asian family in Flushing, New York. Now it's like completely Asian. We were so new that when I think they brought me into the second grade, as soon as I sat down, the entire school made it a point to stop by my class and peek in, because they'd never seen an Asian kid before. That's how new it was. So, it was not done in a bad way or distasteful. They just never seen an Asian kid. They seen them in movies, but never seen in person. They embraced me and they started to teach me English. The comic book industry kind of had a start within the Jewish community. So a lot of the creators were originally from the Jewish origin. Jack Kirby, Stan Lee, Siegel, and in fact, one of the most famous character, Superman, is based on a Jewish character. So the spit curl that he has is, you know, sort of like the curl from the Hasidic community. That Jewish culture kind of transcended into the comic books, you know, without us knowing, you know, it was very subliminal. But yeah, it did have a Jewish origin, but now every culture is represented and is very diverse.
We'll be back after this break. We meet a comic book writer who not only incorporates comic literature in her college curriculum, but also writes comic books with black superheroes to represent the people who look like her.
According to a 2021 study on representation in comics, the most common ethnicity among comic book characters is white at nearly 68%. Hispanic or Latino characters make up nearly 14%, while Asian characters make up 7.5%. Comparatively, black or African American characters make up only 4.3% of those shown.
I would say I believe that comics are literature because they're works that are engaging in various aspects of literary study in the same way, except that they're illustrated. When we talk about the study of literature, we're talking about something that is supposed to have more than just a single dimensional approach or aspect. But, I mean, we could go right down the street and get a slice of pizza and unpack all the different layers and levels of the crust, the cheese, the sauce. So if you can do it with a slice of pizza, we can definitely do it with a comic strip, or we can do it with a book chapter. My name is Shamika Ann Mitchell. My title is Associate Professor of English, Rockland Community College, State University of New York. I am from Harlem. I was a bit of a naughty kid, so I was on punishment a lot. I was always grounded for something. Like, there was always something. I didn't walk the dog, I didn't do my chore. There was always something. So I spent a lot of time in my room. And I spent a lot of time in my room reading. So the comics really came into the house through my brother's comic books and the newspaper. I didn't care what was happening in the front of the newspaper. It could have been war, it could have been famine, I didn't care. I always went to the back and I played the puzzles and I would read all of the strips. So the difference between a comic strip and a comic book, they're both sequential art, but a comic strip is going to be much shorter. It may be one panel, it may be two, four panels max. So a panel is a paragraph in illustrated form. So when you look at a comic strip and you see the little boxes, each box is a panel. And so when the script is written, it's written like, you know, panel one, panel two, panel three. But in a comic book, you're telling an extended sequential story. And it's telling a story either complete or it's part of a series. Whereas if it was a comic strip, usually it's gonna either be a daily or a weekly. So that's the difference. I think I wanted to become a comic writer probably when I was an undergrad. And I said, you know, I think I wanna do some of this, you know, but it's like, I can't draw. So thinking about it from that perspective, it's like, well, I could tell a story, but I don't know that I can illustrate it. And then at some point I just said, you know, if I could partner with somebody who illustrates, maybe that would be an avenue. And that's really kind of how it came into being. The writing determines the illustration because the illustrator has to know where to go from the visual perspective based on what the writer has contributed. So when you're looking at a script, just like a film or television script, you know, it may say, you know, the person pans to the left, or they sit, or they pause, or there's a beat. You know, you have to give all of that information. So you may be looking at like a picture of Charlie Brown, right? And he's sitting there with the kite, and he has the string, and the tree is nearby. And all you hear is say like, oh, rats, right? Now, if the kite is red, if the tree is brown, if he's wearing his standard, you know, squiggly lined shirt, if Snoopy is in the background laughing or Lucy's in the background laughing, all of that is a part of what's in the script. SUNY has been very good to me over the years, and it's become like a very happy space to allow for the creative academic work that I do. I didn't see a literature anthology that included comics until there was one anthology called Literature, and it had comics in it. And it was the first time I saw a literature anthology that had comics in it. And it wasn't until then that I said, oh, people are actually using it, because there is a bit of territorialism and there's a bit of elitism. Comics are still looked down on by literature people as like, oh, it's inferior. But there's value in both. And so that's what I think my students enjoy the most. They enjoy the fact that I'm not there to tell them, like, you know, Shakespeare is important, but, you know, August Wilson isn't. The most recent comics projects that I can talk about, there is Joystick Angels with Ray Comics. Joystick always sells out. I'm always like, okay, are there any copies left? And it's like, oh, it's gone. Oh, Queen of Money Renas, Protector of Nubia. And what's interesting about Queen of Money Renas, if I could tell you all of the work I did, first I went and contacted all these different museums. I can't shout them all out, but definitely like the Met Museum, and they all have Nubian collections. And what I thought of was, let's take these artifacts and plug them into our comic strip. And then people can try to find those artifacts in the museum collections. The lack of access of comics in more marginalized communities in the city is an ongoing issue. And so one of the things that I've been really vocal about is the fact that, like, with New York Comic Con, it's like really hard to get tickets now, and the prices have gone up exponentially, but also they're not marketing to all the neighborhoods. And I have to shout out Women in Comics Collective International, because we do a lot with outreach to these communities that a lot of mainstream industry folks have kind of left by the wayside. If you want to find Black creators of comics or animators, the Schomburg Center for Research in Black Culture is one of the premier places for Black comics. We had the ShomCom Black Comic Book Festival this past April. So we do celebrate the indie creators, but we also celebrate some of the mainstream folks. And I like seeing that happen, especially uptown. And, you know, if we're not reaching out, then we don't know what talent is out there. And we don't know what readers are out there.
That's our show. If you want to know more about the guests we featured, check out our Instagram page at Shades of Us TV and online at tv.cuny.edu. I'm Darryl Brown. See you next time on Shades of Us.